I did, forgive me. But I spent most of my career in the military. And when you're in the military, they teach you everything, okay? And in my case, I attended several military schools, and they taught me that when you write something in the Army, or you're gonna write a paper, you have to say it all in the first sentence. You have to say it all in the first sentence. I wish many preachers were like that. So today I'm gonna apply that principle. I'm gonna say it all in the first sentence. Then you follow me after that. So Jesus' transforming power, Jesus' transforming power comes from what he said and what he did. Okay? I think that that's the whole sermon. Jesus' transforming power for what he said and for what he did. Your transforming power as a church comes from what you said and for what you do. Jesus' transforming power, your transforming power for what we said and for what we do. So that's the sermon. Okay, got it? I'm done. Well, not really. When I got here the first time, and I have been blessed with you, great, I have been greatly blessed to come here and assist you. It's been a great blessing. The first thing that calls my attention and continue to call my attention today is how you name your church. You call your church House of Transformation. House of Transformation. Well, I've been Presbyterian for many, many years. All my life. Because I was a child. And when you go to Presbyterian churches, you normally see that they're called Grace Presbyterian Church, or Covenant Presbyterian Church, or Calvary Presbyterian Church, or name after some great man of faith. But I've never seen any Presbyterian church name House of Transformation. And when I saw it, I said, well, what a wonderful name. Because it's go straight right to the truth of what church is all about. It's about transformation. It's about changing minds. Oh, the Greek word for that is metanoia. Changing your mind. Transforming, and all of that because the transforming power of Jesus. So when you look at that, about the transforming power of Jesus, you have to look at him in two ways. First one, Jesus as the philosopher. He taught to us many good lessons about how to live our life. That's what he said. But also we have to look at Jesus for what he did. And he rose from death, and that is our faith. It's not just an empty philosophy alone. It's a faith that changed the world, transformed their mind, and make us to be the house of transformation. So that's what today's scripture is all about. Today's scripture presents to us a series of narrative about what Jesus is telling to his disciples to do. We have the good news in one side, and we also have some very serious warnings. So serious that people have taken it probably too far. And some people in the past have even cut arms, limbs, and do horrible things to themselves. That's not what it is all about. It's a warning. It's a warning, okay, about those who lead people to stumble. But along with that, it's that message. That message to transform the world. That's your mission and mine. Transform the world. So this narrative in the book of Mark comes to us and speaks to us in a very beautiful way. Simple narrative. The disciples were preaching about and they came across what? The preachers. And they told them, no, not to preach because they're not part of the disciples. And what Jesus said, let it do it. Let it do it. Let it do it. From the beginning, Jesus is preaching a gospel of inclusivity. Come, preach the gospel, be part of it. And from the beginning, followers of Jesus apply totally opposite principle. The principle of exclusivity. Oh no, this is just ours. The church from the beginning is to be open and welcoming. And if we are not open and welcoming, we're wrong. Anyone can come to the church and join us. This is the church of Christ, the church of peace, and the church of love. And by doing that, we transform the world. But it's a lot easier to be exclusive. It's a lot easier to say people, no, go away, than to say people, come as you are. It's a lot easier to say, this is mine, than to say, this is yours. And the transforming power of Jesus is from that sense of openness. That all are welcome. That all are part of you. Furthermore, Jesus himself told them, do not stop them. Do not stop them. Let it preach. Let it be part of it. And what a message. Open message to all. Not just that. When you keep looking and look a little bit deeper into the scripture, you will say that the apostle said that we saw them driving out demons in your name and we told them to stop. Well, the time that the Bible was written, there was that understanding that there was a spiritual world next to us. You know, and that spiritual world can affect us, but we cannot affect the spiritual world. That spiritual world can somehow have some entities, and those entities are called demons. They come and affect us, our world. But we have no control over what they do. And that's a very old vision of the world. In my life and journeys, I can tell you one thing. I'm not afraid of those type of demons. I'm afraid of the type of demons that live, eat, and breathe. And there are people, when they choose to do evil things, those really scare me. Because those are the ones who we are telling, come and change. Not by evil, but by the power of love. And Jesus used this thought to open the church, the message for those who are in need. Use this thought to transform an institution that he was living at his time. You know, Jesus was not very well welcomed in the church, in the synagogue of this time. He was instead outside. Those who needed. He was instead bringing comfort, love, and care for those who were in need. That is part of the transforming power of Jesus. And the idea that we are called to be just an elite group is totally away from what the gospel is all about. And Jesus, at the same time, and those are the good news, warned people and warned his disciples not to be a stumble for those who are starting to believe. Not to be stumbled. Instead, to be salt. And he uses this same thought in other passages in the call us to be what? Salt of the earth. I like salt. And we all like salt, don't we? Where are my chemists here? We have anyone like chemists? We got our scientists. Oh, we got scientists. What is salt?
Salt, sodium chloride.
Sodium chloride. Wonderful. You got a name. Sodium chloride. This is fascinating to me. Salt is fascinating. Because if you take sodium by itself, what it does?
It's very reactive.
Very reactive. What happens if you take sodium and you pour it in a cup of water? Sparks just go all over. Sodium is a highly reactive element. Don't you ever try to eat sodium.
No.
It will kill you.
Yeah.
It's poisonous. Highly poisonous. Now, what's the other element? Chloride. Oh my gosh. And what is chloride? The most powerful poison that it is. Chloride. You know how you maintain your house clean and clean those bathrooms, all the fungi that grows in the bathroom? With bleach. And what is bleach? Chloride. Do not ever drink chloride by itself. It will kill you too. Okay? But when you combine, when both of them are perfectly combined, it makes salt. And we like salt. And we need salt to survive. You know, we like salt so much that those of us who work, we own what? Salary. You know that the word salary comes from? Salt. Yes, it comes from salt. Because way in the past, people will mine salt and they were paid with salt because it was such an indispensable item. And it was used as currency. So salary comes from salt. So we all earn our salary today, our portion of salt. Salt is very important. You know, imagine potato chips without salt. That doesn't work. Imagine sunflowers without seed. That doesn't work either. How about peanuts? Salt is the central part of life, you know? Jesus is telling us something here. Very important part of life. My first job as a preacher, actually, I was in seminary. And I was just recently married to my wife. And that was over 30 years ago, for those of you who are curious. And it was in a country church, in a valley, next to the ocean in Puerto Rico. And in the past, people will not mine, because you don't mine salt next to the sea shore, but will collect salt from the ocean. And you know how they do it? There was a big valley, and they will open the gates and let the salt water flood the valley, part of the valley. Then you close the gate, sun's dry, evaporates the water, and what is behind? It's salt. But Jesus gave us a warning about the salt. He said that the salt can't stop to be salt. There's a truth about that. And working over there, I learned that the people will take the salt and they did not have warehouses where to put it. So they will do something very interesting with the salt. They will collect it and they will make big, big, huge mountains of salt. And then to preserve it, they will burn it. They will put a flame against the outside and will crisp and spark and burn and make a crust all around them. And that preserved the salt. Then when you needed the salt, you break the crust and the salt is underneath. I know everything you need to know about salt. So that's how you preserve it. Because if you don't do that, then the salt starts to absorb the moist of the atmosphere. And then for what is good? Just to make roads, to throw it, to use it as a supplement for road building or something. peace, we have to say, salt is wonderful. But churches sometimes are like salt, and they are salty, and they attract people, and people come and join, and it's transformed. But sometimes they lose and they separate the elements, and then they become sodium and chloride. They become highly reactive and highly poisonous. So the good news of the gospel always comes with the good and a warning. And today we're seeing precisely that. You can be a blessing or a curse. You can be salt or sodium and chloride, not being combined. You can be united in the faith or separated from that. And today's message is simple. It's telling us that the transforming power of Jesus comes from these two things. What we say and what we do. And we have to say the good news and to preach the good news by saying it, but also to lead the good news. By backing it up, it's all that we do. And I said, all that we do. Not just one or two things. All that we do. Not just like what we'd like to do instead. All that we do. And it's precisely that what this lesson today is all about. It's about changing. By stop taking positions and embracing our faith in Jesus for all that he said, and embracing our faith in Jesus for what he did. And by doing that, transform this world, which needs so much transformation. Needed on Jesus' time, still needed today. So my brothers and sisters, go and transform the world with the message that you have, with the actions that you do. Embrace it with your mind and with your heart, with your entire life. The message I want to say, the one who say, do not stop them. Just come and join the family. Come and join our faith. Come and become and be one of those who really doesn't put a barrier between you and God. Instead, lift them so all in the world may hear to his voice.